shorthand, and you have to fill that paper up every day. It's curious in a kind of a mirror image way that Professor Chomsky is in total accord with Reed Irvine, who at the right-wing end of the spectrum says exactly what Chomsky does about the insinuating influence of the press, of the big media, as, quote, agenda setters, to use one of the great buzzwords of the time. And, of course, Reed Irvine sees this as a left-wing conspiracy of foisting liberal ideas in both domestic and foreign affairs on the American people. But in both cases, I think that the premise really is an insult to the intelligence of the people who consume news.
Now, to eliminate confusion, all of this has nothing to do with liberal or conservative bias. According to the propaganda model, both liberal and conservative wings of the media, whatever those terms are supposed to mean, fall within the same framework of assumptions. In fact, if the system functions well, it ought to have a liberal bias, or at least appear to, because if it appears to have a liberal bias, that will serve to bound thought even more effectively. In other words, if the press is indeed adversarial and liberal and all these bad things, then how can I go beyond it? They're already so extreme in their opposition to power that to go beyond it would be to take off from the planet. So therefore, it must be that the presuppositions that are accepted in the liberal media are sacrosanct, can't go beyond them. And a well-functioning system would, in fact, have a bias of that kind. The media would then serve to say, in effect, thus far and no further.
We ask, what would you expect of those media on just relatively uncontroversial, guided free market assumptions? And when you look at them, you find a number of major factors entering into determining what their products are. These are what we call the filters. So one of them, for example, is ownership. Who owns them?
The major agenda-setting media, after all, what are they? As institutions in the society, what are they? Well, in the first place, they are major corporations, in fact, huge corporations. Furthermore, they're integrated with and sometimes owned by even larger corporations, conglomerates, so for example, by Westinghouse and GE and so on.
What I wanted to know was how specifically the elites control the media. What I mean is,
I guess... It's like asking, how do the elites control General Motors? Well, why isn't that a question? I mean, General Motors is an institution of the elites. They don't have to control it. They own it. You know?
Except, I guess, at a certain level, I think... I guess I work with student press, and I know like reporters and stuff.
The elites don't control the student press, but I'll tell you something. You try in the student press to do anything that breaks out of conventions, and you're going to have the whole business community around here down on your neck, and the university's going to get threatened, and, you know. I mean, maybe nobody will pay any attention to you. That's possible. But if you get to the point where they don't stop paying attention to you, the pressures will start coming. Because there are people with power. There are people who own the country, and they're not going to let the country get out of control.
What do you think about that?
This is the old cabal theory that that somewhere there's a room with a baize-covered desk, and there are a bunch of capitalists sitting around, and they're pulling strings. These rooms don't exist. I mean, I hate to tell Noam Chomsky this.
You don't share that.
I think it is the most absolute rubbish I've ever heard. This is the current fashion in the universities. You know, it's patent nonsense, and I think it's nothing but a fashion. It's a way that intellectuals have of feeling like a clergy. I mean, there has to be something wrong.
Thank you. So what we have in first place is major corporations which are parts of even bigger conglomerates. Now, like any other corporation, they have a product which they sell to a market. The market is advertisers, that is, other businesses. What keeps the media functioning is not the audience.
They make money from their advertisers. And remember, we're talking about the elite media, so they're trying to sell a good product, a product which raises advertising rates. And ask your friends in the advertising industry, that means that they want to adjust their audience to the more elite and affluent audience. That raises advertising rates. So what you have is institutions, corporations, big corporations, that are selling relatively privileged audiences to other businesses. Well, what point of view would you expect to come out of this? I mean, without any further assumptions, what you'd predict is that what comes out is a picture of the world, a perception of the world, that satisfies the needs and the interests and the perceptions of the sellers, the buyers, and the product. Now, there are many other factors that press in the same direction. If people try to enter the system who don't have that point of view, they're likely to be excluded somewhere along the way. After all, no institution is going to happily design a mechanism to self-destruct. It's not the way institutions function. So they all work to exclude or marginalize or eliminate dissenting voices or alternative perspectives and so on because they're dysfunctional. They're dysfunctional to the institution itself.
Do you think you've escaped the ideological indoctrination of the media and of society that you grew up in?
Have I?
Mm-hmm.
Often not. I mean, when I look back and think of the things that I haven't done that I should have done, it's not a pleasant experience.
So what's the story of young Noam in the schoolyard?
Yeah, another. I mean, that was a personal thing for me. I don't know why it should interest anyone else, but I do remember.
Well, you drew certain conclusions.
Well, yeah, I mean, it had a big influence on me. I mean, I remember when I was about six, I guess, first grade. There was the standard fat kid who everybody made fun of. And I remember in the schoolyard, he was on a, you know, standing on a, right outside the school classroom, and a bunch of kids outside sort of taunting him and, you know, so on. And one of the kids actually brought over his older brother, sort of like from third grade instead of first grade, you know, big kid. And he was going to, you know, beat him up or something. And I remember going up to stand next to him, feeling somebody ought to help him. And I did for a while, and then I got scared and I went away, and I was very much ashamed of it afterwards and sort of felt, you know, not going to do that again. That's a feeling that's stuck with me. You should stick with the underdog. And the shame remained, you know, should have stayed there.
You were already established. You were a professor at MIT. You'd made a reputation. You had a terrific career ahead of you. You decided to become a political activist. Now, here is a classic case of somebody whom the institution does not seem to have filtered out. I mean, you were a good boy up until then, were you? Or you'd always been a slight, some of them you were a rebel.
Yeah, pretty much. I had been pretty much outside.
You felt isolated. You felt out of sympathy with the prevailing currents of American life, but a lot of people do that. Suddenly, in 1964, yeah. You decide, I have to do something
That's about this.
What made you do that?
Well, that was a very conscious decision and a very uncomfortable decision because I knew what the consequences would be. I was in a very favorable position. I had the kind of work I liked. We had a lively, exciting department. The field was going well. Personal life was fine. I was living in a nice place, children growing up. Everything looked perfect, and I knew I was giving it up. And at that time, remember, it was not just giving talks. I began involved right away in resistance. And I expected to spend years in jail and came very close to it. In fact, my wife went back to graduate school in part because we assumed she's going to have to support the children. These were the expectations. And I recognized that if I returned to these interests, which were the dominant interests of my own youth, life would become very uncomfortable. Because I know that the United States, you don't get sent to a psychiatric prison, and they don't send a death squad after you and so on. But there are definite penalties for breaking the rules. So these were real decisions. And it simply seemed at that point that it was just hopelessly immoral not to.
I'm Noam Chomsky. I'm on the faculty at MIT, and I've been